from my heart and from my head. Why don't people understand my intentions with science?
Unfortunate transporter mishap. I'm afraid your normal host appears to be missing. And good riddance, I say. Oh, I could go looking for him, or I could take over his feeble-ass show and rake in the mad dollars. It's high time someone ran this show with discipline and efficiency. I've even found a better way to get gameplay footage for Final Fantasy X-2 without actually having to play it.
Fuck it, I don't want to play anymore!
And it also has the benefit of exacting brutal vengeance on my enemies, such as the fate of all who oppose Dr. Insano, do you hear? But today, I'd like to share with you a story about a movie I saw when I was but a lad. It's the 80s. I'm at a Blockbuster Video looking to rent a VHS tape, and I look, and I see this movie called The Dungeonmaster, and I think, I'm a dungeon master. I like Dungeons and Dragons, and I read Tolkien all the time. But aside from Willow and Krull and God Help You, Hawk the Slayer, there aren't that many fantasy movies to see, really. Oh, but this movie must be about Dungeons and Dragons. It's called The Dungeon Master. Even the back of the box says it's about a hulking warlord who forces a guy to participate in a bizarre Dungeons and Dragons-like game. Well, it sounds like it'll be better than Mazes and Monsters, doesn't it?
Mazes and Monsters is a far-out game.
And it might have been. If this wasn't a cassette tape full of lies, this movie has nothing to do with the game. There are no dungeons in it, nor mastery by anyone thereof. Every person who ever rented this drivel only rented it because the title leads you to believe that this, in some minute way, is related to Dungeons and Dragons. Nobody would have ever rented this movie under its original title, Rage War. Rage War. It sounds like what an asshole 14-year-old would name his crappy Metallica cover band. It sounds like a rejected title for the Ultimate Warriors comic. I hate this movie. I hate its lies. I wasted $1.99 renting this thing, and I will have my revenge! Right away, you know this movie's in trouble when it lists off 7 directors. And ironically, none of them are Alan Smithy. Lord of the Rings didn't need this many frickin' directors. Meet Paul, an IT nerd who seems to be an ace troubleshooter because he's able to fix a computer immediately. But in case that was too subtle for you, here's some blunt force expository trauma.
They told you he was Zyrex's ace troubleshooter.
And I didn't believe him. I called them damn liars.
Look, Paul, why don't I give you a ride home, huh? Come on.
Don, you know I run every day after work.
Wait. An athletic nerd? This is science fiction. I'm serious! Who could possibly relate to a geek who enjoys sunlight? So now we see an atrocious 2-minute jogging and 80s dance montage set to this goofy music. You know, this might have been a good time for the opening credits instead of the other 2-minute intro of text on a black screen. Just saying. Anyway, this whole time we notice Paul adjusting his glasses, and every time he does, the light signals conveniently change to let him run past. That's our hero, blissfully causing horrific injuries and fatalities so he can get home slightly quicker. He can also use his sciency glasses to hack ATMs and steal money so he can buy flowers for his girlfriend. Stealing's okay when you're broke, you see? So help me understand this. This guy has somehow designed an artificial sentience that can perfectly interpret visual data, troubleshoot computer hardware faults by sight, wirelessly hack traffic signals, and steal money from ATMs on command, but he still works as a lowly IT tech. I mean, hello? Patent it! Sell it! Make zillions of dollars! We've just established he has no money to buy groceries, but with his computer he can basically print the stuff! I mean, really? That's it? Traffic signals and ATMs, that's all you want to do with it? My science goggles do useful things that help me take over the world, like, oh, I don't know, all sorts of things. Death rays, of course, telescopic vision, X-ray vision, hypno vision, night vision, flashbang protection. It takes digital photos of like a zillion megapixels. It's got like a terabyte of MP3 space. It opens my garage door and works as a universal remote for my TV. And it's hooked up to Facebook and Twitter. Paul goes back home where we meet Gwen, his girlfriend. Or is she?
Let's get married. Look, it'll be perfect. I talked it over with Cal. It all adds
up. You talked it over with Cal?
Well, yeah.
Oh, God. Why did this happen to me? How did I fall for a guy whose first love is a machine?
But I'm not in love with my computer. I am in love with you.
Oh, I've had this conversation a few times.
You don't understand. What I've developed with Cal, it's what gives me an edge.
Oh, I bet it does.
It's what gives me an edge.
Every time I think about that experiment you were involved in and how you were able to link up.
Whoa, stop the presses! What was that?
Every time I think about that experiment you were involved in and how you were able to link up.
What experiment? Was that backstory you just tried to blitz past me to explain the computer? Talk about hand-waving. You can't just gloss over a thing like the whole invention of an artificial intelligence you can also control with your mind. That's a fairly significant detail, douchebag.
Hey. You can't link up the way we can.
You haven't seen some of the computer peripherals I've invented, have you? I call this one the floppy disk drive.
Let's go to bed. At least that's one place I know I'll have all your attention.
Well, actually, I just loaded the Kama Sutra into Cal, so I thought if I brought the computer into the bedroom, we could... Aw, come back!
Oh, what is this? The computer is watching them have sex! Look, its lenses burn with jealousy! That night he has a nightmare. He's in a ridiculous costume, and his girlfriend is bathing in a waterfall with all her clothes on. What? Oh no! It's a mime nightmare! The worst kind! Any minute now, he's going to be blown away by imaginary wind! He wakes up in his smoky apartment only to be immediately teleported to another dimension, where Gwen is chained to a rock. I can only presume it's the Black Hole. That's when a wizard shows up and casts a dorky wardrobe spell on them.
You are a worthy opponent for Mistima. Now you have old power centered on you. You may call on your machines. Your magic. Machines. Kneel
before Zul!
He gives Paul a weapon by turning his computer into a wrist-mounted thingy.
The power of the Prince of Darkness! This is the end of time!
I, Mistima, have devised 7 challenges. Lose one. Just one. And I shall have both your souls.
Mistima? His name sounds like some kind of hemorrhoid infection, or some kind of weird tropical disease.
When I found out that I had Mistima, I could barely get out of bed in the morning.
When I was diagnosed with Mistima, I couldn't even leave the flat.
Hello, I'm Dr. Insano. Mistima is a serious medical condition that affects over 7 people a year, and nobody wants to talk about it.
I first suspected I had Mistima when my urine began to taste like chocolate milk.
I was constipated, miserable, when all I could do was guzzle cheap lager and peanuts, watching Benny Hill until I passed out.
I was growing hair in places that you wouldn't believe.
My ass began to melt like a bowl of Jell-O left out in the midday sun.
And that's why I've developed this new miracle lotion, Excalibrate. It targets your Mistimas for fast, soothing relief you can rely on.
Mistima turned me into a 400-pound whale. But ever since I started taking Excalibrate, I've finally been able to fit back into my prom dress.
Now, thanks to Excalibrate, I can finally wear a thong to the beach again.
Thank you, Excalibrate.
Thank you, Excalibrate. And thank you, Dr. Insano.
If you have a Mistima and don't know where to turn, try Excalibrate. Available wherever fine prophylactics and lubricants are sold.
I think my favorite part of his costume is his giant 4-foot wingspan hang glider collar. Why can't I ever find a lab coat with one of those?
But I'm Paul Bradford from Cyrex!
So Paul gets zapped and awakens in a strange land for his first challenge. which is a couple of forest midgets sneaking up on him and stealing his computer, then running away. And this goes on for quite a while, really. Fear the midgets of Mestima! The midgets hide the computer near a giant monkey temple and continue to run away. Not really sure what the point of that was, but the monkey statue suddenly comes to life and attacks. Wait, hold on, what? He just fired a laser out of his computer thingy. Since when could... How did he know we could do that? Did he just make that up on the fly? Science does not work that way! You can't just make up science-y powers with no explanation like this. That'd be like me spontaneously throwing lightning bolts out of my fingers screaming, SCIENCE! Eventually, he manages to zap a laser straight into the jewel and kills it. Gosh, isn't this just like Dungeons & Dragons? The next challenge pits him against a mob of the undead, which he easily defeats by just shooting them with his laser. Again! That's when he's suddenly confronted with a puppet on a pile of shit!
Greetings, Excalibrates! Welcome to my domain! I am Rotsmith! Caretaker of the Dead!
I don't know, I guess I just expected the Lord of the Dead not to look like Salacious Crumb. Finally, he's confronted with a zombie of himself, which doesn't really do anything. It just sort of stares at him and vanishes. Huh.
How is it that you can destroy that which is your own destiny?
That creature was not my destiny.
Mestima has foreseen it!
In a future reality, I shall destroy you.
I reject your reality and I substitute my own.
I reject your reality and substitute my own.
Well, that just blew my mind! What in the hell does that even mean? Mestima gets pissed off and summons an animated dragon with his magic, so Paul summons his own purple dragon in the sky. Yes, Paul has a dragon summoning program loaded onto his computer. And they just sort of posture there and remain perfectly motionless for a few seconds before vanishing. Mistima's next challenge sends Paul to a wasp concert. Yes, a wasp concert. Mestima, you mad fool! What man could possibly withstand rock this awesome? Apparently the band Wasp has Gwen kidnapped now, and they menace her by gently rubbing a machete on her thighs. Whatever gets you off, I guess. Oh, but Paul has a brilliant plan! He blows them up by zapping them with his computer! Are you sensing a theme here?
He exploded on stage.
Just like that?
He just went up.
He just was like a flash of green light. That was it. Nothing was left.
His face.
Well, there was.
It's actually true. This truly did happen.
There was a little green globule on his drum seat.
Like a stain. You know, dozens of people spontaneously combust each year. It's just not really widely reported.
Right.
Yeah.
The next challenge seals our heroes in an icy cavern filled with statues of famous murderers like the Wolfman, Jack the Ripper,
this guy,
and Albert Einstein. Wait, what?
Looks like every criminal in the world is here.
What, did Einstein go on a killing spree I'm not aware of? Gwen starts to freeze solid until, she stops. And then the statues come to life, of course. Paul shoots the criminal samurai with his laser, drops the Ripper with a boulder instead of his laser, and then throws the crystal that Einstein's hand at the monsters, which explodes, huh? I think I'm losing my mind again, even worse than last time. Did Einstein just not file the patent for his ice crystal bomb? What the hell is going on? Mestima tries to get Paul to give up the challenge since his laser is pretty much killing everything.
Say the word and it ends.
The word is forget it.
Wait, sorry, that's two words, but you know what I mean.
Let me see, let me think. What would tempt you?
I offer you freedom and wealth sufficient to create your own empire.
I'd say I know him pretty well, Mestima.
Oh?
and let me tell you, the next challenge is a real break from routine. Gwen's in danger, so Paul has to run, and then zaps the killer with his laser. Then Mistima summons a demon, and Paul zaps it with his laser. Then he goes to Yor's world, where he hears Gwen's in danger in a cave, and inside, there's a hideous goblin throwing explosive crystals at him, so he zaps it with his laser. I feel like I've watched the exact same scene a dozen times now. Maybe because I have. Every freaking scene in this movie is...
Gwen!
Paul, help me!
Where's Gwen?
Paul.
Paul? Are you there, Paul?
Gwen!
Paul! Paul?
Gwen!
Paul!
Okay, actually, he misses with the laser, and the monster just sort of causes the cave to collapse on itself. This is what's known in D&D as rolling a botch and fucking the whole encounter up. Not that the writer of this crap ever played D&D. Then the hideous slain monster turns into an angel. What?
You would have won by simply walking out of the cave.
I didn't know.
Well, if she's an angel, why in the hell did she start chucking explosives at him in the first place? Duh. Then they appear in some airplane graveyard, which I guess is supposed to pass for a Mad Max post-apocalyptic wasteland. Then some evil sand people drive up, led by a master blaster midget in a dune buggy, who just sort of gibbers at them and acts like an idiot. Well, he looks like Master Blaster to me. It's not my fault, they're the ones who can't get beyond Thunderdome. And what is with this movie's hatred of little people? This is what, the third time they've been menaced by evil dwarfs? I like little people. They have tiny hands, which are good at working on electronics. And when I take over the world, they'll be ideal for working in the mines. So they somehow get overwhelmed and disarmed by the dwarf, and see if you can guess how Paul gets out of this one. Well, go on. You'll never guess. Not in a million years. Paul's shown so much innovation and creativity solving all the problems up to this point, he's like freaking MacGyver. Guess how he does it. Go on. Guess. Guess.
Fire.
Ah!
I... The Excalibrate. Challenge you to a real contest.
You have some trick up your sleeve, eh?
One man against one man. In this arena, no magic.
You cannot be serious.
My magic is powerful. All powerful.
Only mortals who risk losing can know real excitement.
His plan is to get Mistima into a fair fight by challenging the size of his dick. This is the dumbest thing a proper villain can do! Didn't you ever see Commando?
I just want to pull a trigger. Put a knife in me.
I don't need no gun!
It is a trick. I know it's a trick.
Trust me.
I don't even know why I'm complaining. This is the first problem the whole movie hasn't tried to solve by just shooting it in the face. And the giant Mistima strikes with a girly slap. It becomes immediately evident that they don't exactly teach mixed martial arts at wizard school because Mistima gets his big ass kicked from minute one. I mean, look at him! Dude's wide open for a triangle choke with his arm out there like that. In desperation, Mistima tries to summon his magic to cause an earthquake, but it doesn't do anything except cause him to fall to his death. Dumbass. Paul's about to fall as well until his computer summons some kind of solid bar of light that he hangs onto to escape. Oh sure, why not? It does everything else. It's like a Green Lantern ring. Then they just go back to the house and the movie immediately ends. I mean, all this happens within about 20 seconds. It's called a denouement movie. You've got 7 directors and you couldn't find someone to direct an ending? The worst part of this is, I should love this movie. It's about a guy killing stuff with vague, undefined science. But it's just stupid and repetitive. Worst of all, it's deceptive. This should be about a dungeon master, or at least a rage war, something. I wanted a Dungeons and Dragons movie. Why is that so hard? Where is my Dungeons and Dragons movie? Bruce Payne. Oh, it seems like a scientist's work is never done. Ugh. We'll be right back.
closely. I'm waiting for you. The wolf with the sheepskin's clothing. My chops and your taste in you. You ain't ever walked into you. Your ass to the sheets. Now the crust and the sweat start to sting you. I fight like a beast.
Breathing, work it out. This game sucks.